Welcome to today's 2020 Awards podcast. Today we're going to be looking back at the entire year of 1992 and talking about the final nominees for the upcoming 2020 Awards ceremony, which is happening here in Seattle at Seattle's Fremont Abbey Arts Center on February 16th at 8 o'clock. And if you want to come to the show, tickets are still available, only $10, best deal in town. And I'd like to welcome co-host Danny Cork.
Hello.
Nicely done. And our producer and engineer, Lee Kristofferson.
Hey, Chris.
Hi, Lee. There's a lot of categories. We're not going to go through all of them, but we're going to try and hit the bigger ones. If you go to our website, which is 2020awards.org, and if you go to the nav bar at the top, click on nominees and awards, and then scroll over to 2013 nominees, and you'll see the entire list of everything that has been nominated. You'll see the original Academy Award nominees from 20 years ago, and you'll see the new nominees on the left.
Oh, I'm looking at it right now.
Oh, okay. Well, we'll assume everybody's there by now. So why don't we start with Best Adapted Screenplay? And Danny, you have a lovely voice. Why don't you read off who they are?
Okay, it looks like we got Richard Friedenberg for A River Runs Through It, Bo Goldman for Scent of a Woman, Ruth Prower... Oh, gosh, you bastard. Ruth Prower...
I didn't name her.
Ruth Prower Jabvala. I'm butchering that atrociously, I'm sure. For Howard's End, David Mamet, Glengarry Glen Ross, Michael Tolkien for The Player. And it looks like all of these people, with the exception of Mamet, were nominated in the 1993 Academy Awards. So who's
Peter Barnes.
Okay, so it looks like Peter Barnes for Enchanted April has not been nominated by the 2020s and had previously been nominated by the Academy Awards and is now replaced by David Mamet.
Any shocks or upsets in here, you guys? Anything you see?
I thought Scent of a Woman was just a terrible movie.
Yes.
And I'm surprised that got nominated again.
It is a little shocking. Yeah, I have to say I'm pretty surprised that's back in here.
Yeah, Howard's End won the Oscar in
93. Right.
I love Howard's End.
I know
and
you
I'm
do.
I have to say
Howard's End wound up Unforgiven got 9 nominees this year and Howard's End came in with 8. And I'm kind of shocked that movie had any legs.
Really?
I have to say. Yeah.
It's a timeless movie. I think that probably
It's an endless movie.
Oh.
I think that's what she meant.
I love the Merchant Ivory movies, so yeah. I'm a sucker for those.
I don't know. Danny, what's your take on this?
My take on Howard's End?
General, on this list.
Well, first of all, I think seeing Glengarry Glen Ross, this is the first of a lot of nominations this got, and that was clearly kind of ignored 20 years ago. I think its reputation has grown. so I think you're seeing that reflected here. I've seen Howard's End once. It was 10 years ago, and like I say, the only thing I recall from it was a bookshelf fell on someone at the end.
Spoiler alert.
All I remember.
Well, you know, it's funny, because when I saw the movie just recently, I could not for the life of me remember if I'd seen this movie before, and then the bookshelf falls on the guy. I was like, oh yeah, I've seen this. And then the movie's over.
I think people tend to turn off their critical blinkers for a lot of period movies, especially these kind of Edwardian dramas. I think you've seen that going on now with Downton Abbey, which I think is a good show. But I think it seems like everybody seems to regard things where people speak very flowery
right.
as being particularly great. And I think it's an okay show. Like, this is an okay movie from what I remember. I don't remember it being a bad movie. I just don't remember the movie. I mean, what are we awarding here? We're awarding movies that have stood the test of time, that have lingered in the memory. And again, 10 years ago, I saw it. I remember a bookshelf fell on someone. So maybe that's a Philistine's opinion of a really great movie. But
I don't know.
All right. Who do you think's going to win this category? Who's your favorite?
Well, you know, my favorite didn't get nominated. I think League of Their Own should have been in this list.
Oh, I liked League of Their Own.
Yeah. It's actually one of the few movies I think where I feel like that's a great script but badly directed. Like, oh. I feel like I can, if like if I'd seen that, if that movie had been made by somebody else, I think it would have been a much stronger film. But I think it's a great script. So, of this bunch, I think I voted for The Player.
Oh, The Player's terrific. I'd be happy if that won.
What's your guys' big problem with Scent of a Woman?
Where do I start? I don't
care about the main character. He's blind. Okay, big deal. A lot of people are blind.
Yeah. I mean, that's part of it.
Don't make a big deal about
it. It's also, the whole message of the movie is very weird to me. It's like, better to lie than rat out, you know, snitches get stitches, I guess, is kind of the message of the movie. I don't know. The movie just felt kind of meandering and pointless to me.
Yeah, I remember thinking it was really long. It's like 2.5 hours long.
Yeah.
And any movie that ends with a big speech scene, that's mm-hmm. a big red flag for me. But it wasn't abrasive to me. You know, I'm not a fan of it by any means. I'm surprised, you know, it was nominated for all of these awards, as well as, you know, like I was saying, I think it won some Golden Globes.
All right, so we move on to Best Original Screenplay.
Well, who would you guys, if you guys were voting, who would you vote for based on this bunch?
The Player.
God, you know, I like, there are parts of Glengarry Glen Ross that I love, but I think the Player has a stronger story, so.
Best Original Screenplay, and the nominees are
Woody Allen, Husbands and Wives, Roger Avery and Quentin Tarantino, Reservoir Dogs, Neil Jordan, The Crying Game, Baz Luhrmann and Craig Pearce, Strictly Ballroom, and David Webb Peoples, Unforgiven.
Well, there's two new ones that were not nominated for Oscars, Reservoir Dogs and Strictly Ballroom. And who lost out was John Sayles for Passion Fish, and George Miller and Nick Enright for Lorenzo's Oil.
Yeah, I would say there's no surprises here for me. Actually, I'm happily surprised to see Strictly Ballroom on the list. I do think that comedies or anything that's light in general kind of gets snubbed when it comes time for awards, and so I was pleasantly surprised to see that up there.
I'm glad Reservoir Dogs got a nomination. I liked all of these scripts.
Yeah?
Yeah. Neil Jordan won the Oscar.
Right.
For The Crying Game.
Yep. Yeah. Danny and I watched The Crying Game, and I gotta say, I feel like it felt like a first draft watching it this time.
Hmm. Yeah, it was not good. I mean, even you remember that bartender character? There was like the bartender was like the wizened sage-like figure that had the answers to everything, despite the fact that he had a packed bar. He was willing to talk to this, you know, this down and out guy, and it just there's so many problems with that movie.
Yeah. Especially the third act, because the IRA characters come back into the movie. And it just becomes this whole other movie.
Yeah.
It becomes this weird sort of...
And it doesn't become... It's not as pregnant with the violence and danger of the first act, where it felt like, wow, these are guys that mean business. It felt like the last act of the movie was a caper. That's what it felt like, you know?
Even to the point where, well, that's outside of script, but I mean, even the characters, like the Miranda Richardson character comes dressed like a femme fatale all of a sudden with a Betty Page haircut. And it's like, wait, what movie am I watching now?
Yeah, because originally she was like Doc Martens and sweaters.
Well, she was a terrorist. She was a fanatic. Yeah.
Yeah.
It was.
Yeah. And then, it's very weird. It's like suddenly it's like this whole other movie. So I also think, personally, I think the movie would have been stronger had the audience been in on the fact that Jay Davidson, spoiler alert, if Jay Davidson had been revealed earlier as a dude, because then there's this superior position where you're waiting to see how Stephen Ray's character is going to react once he discovers that the woman he's in love with is a man. And so, you know, instead you just get a big shock instead of suspense. I know I didn't vote for this or when it came time to nominate.
Is there anything that you think should have been nominated that isn't?
I mean, three of the films, Strictly Ballroom, Unforgiven, and Husbands and Wives, I nominated. So I've got 60% representation here. And those are the three I think that I'd vote for one of those three. I think I voted for Unforgiven. Who would you vote for, Lee?
Either Husbands and Wives or Reservoir Dogs.
Danny?
I'm somewhere between Husbands and Wives and Unforgiven. You know, and you can, I think Unforgiven is a great movie that plays on the genre. I think it bookends the Western. I think it's a fantastic movie. And yeah, I think it's largely due to that script. Yeah, I think there's some strong things here in comparison to it. I'm more inspired by this, these original screenplays than the adapted screenplays. But
yeah, moving on. Best Supporting Actress, and the nominees are
Helena Bonham Carter, Howard's End; Judy Davis, Husbands and Wives; Vanessa Redgrave, Howard's End; Pat Thompson, Strictly Ballroom; and Marissa Tomei, My Cousin Vinny.
And the original nominees are
Judy Davis, Husbands and Wives; Joan Plowright, Enchanted April; Vanessa Redgrave, Howard's End; Miranda Richardson, Damage; and Marissa Tomei, My Cousin Vinny.
And she won.
She won. I think that's a terrific performance. I hope she wins again. I loved it.
I just saw it for the first time here a few months ago, mm-hmm. and I think it's fine. I'm a little surprised she won 20 years ago, and I'm probably equally surprised that she's back on the list. But
why is that?
I don't know. I think maybe the character just feels too cartoonish for me.
I think you said this was a great year for comedy. I think My Cousin Vinny was... Did you like the movie in general?
I actually fell asleep.
Oh, did you?
It's 2 hours long. It doesn't need to be 2 hours long.
I loved it. I've seen it a few times. I think I had it on VHS.
I think if had it been 90 minutes, I think it would have been a pretty good movie. As a two-hour movie, I was just like, let's move it along, guys.
Pat Thompson, did she play the antagonist in Strictly Ballroom?
Yeah, she plays the lead's mom.
She was great. I remember I've seen that once, and it was years ago, and she still kind of looms large in my memory as being kind of a terrible harridan, you know. I think
she's pretty amazing. And speaking of cartoonish, when I went in to watch Strictly Ballroom again this year, my immediate reaction to her was, oh God, this is going to be one of those, like, oh, I remember her now. This is going to be one of those movies where she's really just a stereotype and a cartoon. And about a half hour in, I was totally hooked by her. I thought she was fantastic. And so like, kind of, I feel like whatever she brought, I feel like Marissa Tomei kind of didn't bring to her role. Hmm. I think this was a kind of a weak year for the ladies in movies, and maybe that's why she's there. I don't know, but I think
there was better supporting roles than lead roles this year for women.
I think so too. I'm totally cool with Pat Thompson being there. I think she's fantastic, and Judy Davis. Those are my two front runners. In fact, I haven't voted for those for this category yet because I'm kind of torn between those two parts.
Yeah, Judy Davis was terrific in Husbands and Wives. See, I'm kind of bummed that she was supporting. So she was the lead in that. I thought she was the lead in that movie.
I kind of agree.
It's an ensemble, so it's kind of hard to tell who the lead is.
You know, the Howard's End ladies, I think they're good, but it just kind of... I feel like I'm watching PBS when I'm watching that movie. And it's like, they're good, but they don't... I don't know. They don't bring anything to these roles that make them memorable for me. So,
well, I think Judy Davis and Marissa Tomei definitely had those were memorable roles. Those are pretty much their defining roles.
Yeah. Who would you vote for?
I'd probably vote for Judy Davis, but I like Marissa Tomei, so I'm a little torn on that one.
Yeah. Danny?
It'd be nice to see Judy Davis or Pat Thompson get something.
I'm trying to think. No.
Think of anybody that should have been nominated that wasn't. I can't think of anybody.
You know,
Michelle Pfeiffer, Batman Returns, as Catwoman.
Oh,
that was such a great performance.
She got a few votes.
Yeah, I think that I would have liked to have seen that.
Meow.
Well, on that note, let's take a break and hear a word from our sponsors. Scarecrow Video is one of the largest independent video stores in the country, located in Seattle's beautiful University District. One of the last remaining brick-and-mortar stores featuring DVDs, VHS, Laserdisc, and Blu-ray. If you can't find a movie at Scarecrow, it hasn't been filmed yet. For more info, visit scarecrowvideo.com. Located in a converted dentist's office, the Grand Illusion is Seattle's classiest, weirdest, and completely volunteer-operated cinema, screening the world's finest art house, foreign, and revival films. Located in the University District, right across from the Jack in the Box. For more info, visit grandillusioncinema.org. Best Supporting Actor. And the nominees are...
Alec Baldwin, Glengarry Glen Ross, Jay Davidson for The Crying Game, Gene Hackman, Unforgiven, Jack Lemmon, Glengarry Glen Ross, Jack Nicholson, A Few Good Men.
And the original nominees are...
The actors not nominated who were up for Academy Awards were Al Pacino and in Glengarry Glen Ross and David Paymer for Mr. Saturday Night.
The new nominees are Alec Baldwin and Jack Lemmon, both of them from Glengarry Glen Ross. And the Oscar back then went to Gene Hackman in Unforgiven.
I think this is a good category. I think all these guys did a great job.
I'm going to say I think... I really would have liked to have seen Al Pacino and Glengarry Glen Ross get nominated. I think he's awesome in that movie. I think he's a force of nature. You know, he's great.
You do have a soft spot for...
I do, but in that role, that bravado is necessary. He's a salesman.
I think he works great in that. You're right.
I think
he was very good.
That kind of Pacino over-the-topness is appropriate there. And I'm bummed out that he's not nominated. And yes, I like Alec Baldwin, but I think Pacino was better in that movie.
Oh, I disagree. I think Baldwin made that movie. I think the only reason, or one of the only reasons why that movie is still relevant is that scene.
I agree.
I think that scene.
Totally agree. That's the only thing I remember from that movie until I watched it recently. Looking at this list, I'm kind of surprised Jack Lemmon is in this category and not Best Actor, because to me he feels like the lead in that movie.
But I think with ensembles, they're always supporting roles. I feel like there isn't really a lead.
It just feels like, I don't know, he feels like the main character to me.
What's the criteria? Do you just nominate wherever they want? Or?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Gene Hackman's going to be hard to beat, though.
Gene Hackman, I think, is fantastic.
I think the only one that can beat him is Alec Baldwin.
Nicholson, I didn't quite enjoy his role as much when I saw A Few Good Men 20 years ago. Have a little bit more of an appreciation for it now. Jay Davidson in The Crying Game. Come on, I feel like he showed his wang dang doodle, and that's why he's
because he played a woman.
Yeah, but I mean,
it was a good performance.
I think it feels like a trick.
It feels like a trick. Feel like when an actor makes his or her debut and they leave an impression, and then they're never in anything else again. You only know them in that role. So it's kind of like...
It's hard to tell with context.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. And I feel like he made an indelible impression given the content and what happens in that movie and the fact that he was, in Stargate as the villain, not even using his own voice after this. So it's kind of hard to gauge where it's at, you know. Whereas I think there are some people that when they make their name in a movie and they get this nomination and then that's all you see them do and you're like, well, they weren't really acting that well, you know what I mean? So it's kind of hard to gauge.
Well, I feel like that whole movie comes down to a shocking moment, and that's why 20 years later it's still
in your mind.
Yeah, I'm a little surprised by some of the people that are not in this category.
Tell me.
I'm surprised there's no one else from Reservoir Dogs in here. I'm like
Harvey Keitel.
Yeah, although
Michael
again,
Madsen.
He's
Michael Madsen. I think that's a good one.
Madsen, Steve Buscemi, Lawrence Tierney, who plays
My Way or the Highway.
Yeah, I mean those are like
they're all great roles.
Like that, like this whole category could have been that cast.
Oh, for sure.
But the other person that I'm really bummed at that's not on here is Sydney Pollack.
I agree with you 100%. I knew you. Yeah.
Yeah.
He was so good. Everybody in that movie was so good. Yeah. So I think that Judy Davis just stuck out more than everybody else. Yeah.
So, yeah, this is... And I don't know. To me, I always think Best Supporting Actor is almost the most interesting category. Or it's like the one
it's
that...
There's, the best part.
It's the one that there's the most candidates to choose from. Who would you vote for, Lee? Of the ones here?
Either Alec Baldwin or Gene Hackman. It's hard to say vote for Gene Hackman for anything he does.
Yeah.
I think he'll win.
I mean, that's my vote, hands down.
I got Gene Hackman, Jack Lemmon.
Yeah.
I'm not as big a Baldwin fan.
Moving along, Best Actress, and the nominees are...
Gina Davis for A League of Their Own, Whoopi Goldberg in Sister Act, Susan Sarandon in Lorenzo's Oil, Sharon Stone in Basic Instinct, and Emma Thompson in Howard's End.
And there's a couple of new faces here.
There's all new faces, but Emma Thompson...
Susan Sarandon.
Oh, yeah, Susan Sarandon, sorry.
Gina Davis, Whoopi Goldberg, and Sharon Stone have replaced Catherine Deneuve in Indochine, Mary McDonnell in Passion Fish and Michelle Pfeiffer in Love Field.
And it's actually, I kind of like this, some of these nominees, because you've got some comedy here, you've got Basic Instinct, you've got things that are outside of the traditional drama roles that people are nominated for. I think it's nice when anytime you recognize comedy.
This is definitely the most interesting. The original nominees, it was like, just give it to Emma Thompson. It doesn't even matter who else is on that list.
Right.
And Lorenzo's Oil, I don't remember that being that good of a movie.
I still haven't seen it.
Don't bother. I'm surprised Sharon Stone's on there.
Okay, I'm surprised both Sharon Stone and Whoopi Goldberg are on there. Sharon Stone, I think we just had this conversation about Jay Davidson. I mean, I really feel like there's one thing about this movie that everybody remembers. And it's...
What's that?
It's that ice pick.
It's that white dress she wore.
It doesn't work in an audio medium.
Yeah.
I'd have to be pretty stupid to write a book about killing and then kill somebody the way I described it in my book. I'd be announcing myself as the killer.
Clearly, the syndicate has nominated her, so they're seeing something. What do you think that is?
I think it's what they remember. You know, it's like...
It's a memorable role.
I don't think that's true. You think it's just because they remember that?
Have you seen the movie?
Yeah, I've seen the movie several times. I actually like Basic Instinct. I think it's a well-done movie.
I think it's a well-done movie. I think it's entertaining while you're watching it. I don't think there's anything in it that real. Actually, I think the score is good, and I actually can't.
I think the score is great.
I think the script is not. I think in a different year, this script shouldn't be nominated. But I think in this, I don't know. I think this is a kind of a weak year that I came very close to nominating the script this year.
Oh, okay.
But that said, performance-wise, I don't know if I would. I personally think she's a great villain.
I'm not saying because I have to be honest with you. I haven't seen many of these movies, or I haven't seen them in so long.
I really just don't think I have.
I've never seen Sister Act.
I really don't care to venture
what I want to win. But I do think she was a great villain. She was a great villain. Nice,
but I think that's the character, not the performance.
Well, it might be. I mean, but I don't know. Maybe there's a sort of intertwined in the mind of the those who nominated her. But.
True.
I'm really excited that Gina Davis got nominated for A League of Their Own.
Are you? Why?
I don't know. I'm a big Gina Davis fan.
Yeah.
There was a good part. The year before, she did Thelma and Louise, and this was just completely different.
Mm-hmm.
It showed a lot of range. She's funny. She's athletic.
I
totally believe that she was the star baseball player.
Sure.
Does anybody think that Hanks was overlooked? Because that was kind of his first...
We're not there yet.
Oh, we're not on supporting actor? He was supporting.
He was the lead.
In A League of Their Own?
He's a lead actor.
He was supporting in that, surely.
Who was the lead actor in that movie then?
There wasn't one.
What do you mean lead actor? They didn't have to have one, do you?
If there's an actor, if there's a main actor, it's Tom Hanks in that movie.
Right, but he's not. But he's a supporting actor in that movie, right?
I agree with Danny.
Really?
He's like a supporting part. That's not an act. I mean,
yeah,
it's
he's
been
not
years,
the, I mean,
so
the
I might
lead
be wrong.
Of that movie is Gina Davis.
Right, she's the lead. He's
He supports her. He supports her performance. It's a definition of a supporting actor.
Well, anyway, do you?
I agree with you, but I think I came close to putting him down as best actor.
Are you crying? Are you crying? There's no crying. There's no crying in baseball.
Who are you going to vote for?
I have no idea. I'm.
You don't. I don't think you like any of the performances.
I'm not crazy about any of these.
Who did you put down?
I don't remember her name, but the lead actress from Strictly Ballroom.
Okay.
I think she was the best performance of the year. I think Judy Davis should be in this category, not supporting actress. And again, I go back to Meryl Streep, Goldie Hawn for Death Becomes Her, and then Rosie Perez for White Men Can't Jump.
She was supporting, though. Even though she was the leading female.
Right.
That was
See,
the supporting
this is,
part.
This is where I think it comes down to who's got the... I don't know what the rules are. There are no rules
for the Oscars.
Yeah.
It's just whatever you campaign for.
Yeah. So, I don't know who I would vote for in this. I'm still kind of torn. Lee?
Emma Thompson.
Yeah.
For Howard's End. But you know how I feel about Howard's End.
I know. And that's probably who I'm going to vote for. But
I think that's going to be an overwhelming victory for her.
Yeah.
Oh, thank you so much. What a lovely thought. Thank you.
Best actor.
Robert Downey Jr. for Chaplin. Clint Eastwood, Unforgiven. Stephen Ray, The Crying Game. Tim Robbins, The Player. Denzel Washington, Malcolm X.
And the one new face here is Tim Robbins, who replaced Oscar winner Al Pacino in Scent of a Woman.
I think that poor Al Pacino. But that role is just, I think it just ruined him for everybody.
I agree.
It's just bad.
I have a hard time convincing myself that he's the same guy that's in The Godfather.
I'm in the dark here! Do you understand?
Oh, it's so bad.
It's weird. You can almost divide his career into movies before and after Scent of a Woman.
Well, they finally rewarded him for hamming it up, and then he never stopped.
Yeah.
I just feel like that just it goes, name a bad performance in a movie, and that's 90% of the people are going to say Al Pacino, Scent of a Woman.
It's the first person
on their mind. Would you love him in this movie?
No, not necessarily. I just feel like there's a lot of Al Pacino bagging, and I love him.
Oh, I love him. Pacino's great.
I remember the first podcast we did. I mentioned that this was a Lifetime Achievement Award for him, and you were like, "What? Really?" You were shocked that I would say that, but that's what that was to me.
I hate when they do that. Yeah. When somebody wins and they don't deserve it for that performance, just give them a Lifetime Achievement Award.
Yeah,
in that case, don't. Yeah.
I'm sorry. I feel like the one that doesn't belong is Tim Robbins in The Player. And I like Tim Robbins, but I think he just kind of...
He wasn't very
dynamic. I felt like
he
was somewhat arbitrary in that film.
I was going to say I would rather see him nominated for Bob Roberts.
Oh, I love Bob Roberts. Yeah. That came out for that year?
Yep.
Oh, absolutely. I love Bob Roberts.
So, see, I think Gary Oldman should be here for Dracula.
Mm.
I think Jack Lemmon should be here for Glengarry. And Nicholson for Hoffa.
You know, you're going to kill me. I would like to have seen Tom Cruise for A Few Good Men in there.
No. Yeah. No, you're just saying that to piss me off.
I'm not just saying that.
Really?
I'd like that. I like that movie. I thought it was a good performance. He fit that character.
He couldn't swing a bat.
I don't care if he can swing a bat. He was just practicing. He was just lobbing balls for people. God. He wasn't playing baseball.
Who would you take off this list for that?
I wouldn't take any of them off. I would just like to have a sixth. maybe
everybody
wins. Maybe Stephen Ray.
You just carve the Oscar into six pieces. Right.
Stephen Ray, I don't remember understanding a word he said in that movie.
Yeah.
It's like all mumble mouth.
I'm not a huge fan of his performance in there.
I'm not a huge fan of his performance in anything, really.
I think Downey Jr. is a fantastic actor. I haven't seen Chaplin in a long time. I think my two favorites there are Denzel in Malcolm X. I thought he was brilliant, super charismatic, held a movie for 200 minutes. And I think Clint Eastwood should win. I think that's easily his best, the performance of his career. I think he's great.
I would like to see him win too.
He's great. He's fantastic. I want to see him win.
I totally agree with that. Although, my vote is going to Denzel.
I think it's going to be a pretty tight race between Denzel and Clint Eastwood.
Yeah. And actually, I think it's going to be tight between Denzel and Downey.
Oh, I don't know.
And I got to say, it's like, I think Downey's good, but I don't know. Chaplin, like, it just didn't do it for me, the whole movie. And I find his performance in it just to kind of be a little bit wanting. I think Eastwood's fantastic in Unforgiven, but I also think that Denzel in Malcolm X, especially if you've seen any footage of Malcolm X, he nails that
in America,
so well.
You have to understand the difference. We didn't come over on the Nina, the Pinta, and the whatchamacallit. We didn't land on Plymouth Rock. Plymouth Rock landed on us.
Yeah. Yeah,
I think he's
going
to win. I think it'll be Denzel.
I think it'll be Denzel.
It should have been Denzel 20 years ago. It should have
been 20 years ago for sure.
So who was it?
Al Pacino.
Oh, yeah. Is that forgettable?
How'd this food get in my mouth?
Hoorah!
Best director.
Woody Allen, Husbands and Wives. Robert Altman, The Player. Clint Eastwood, Unforgiven. Neil Jordan, The Crying Game. Quentin Tarantino, Reservoir Dogs.
And new to the list are Woody Allen and Tarantino.
They're both well-deserved.
And they are replacing Martin Brest for Son of a Woman and James Ivory for Howard's End.
Good, Martin Brest, Son of a Woman. Yeah, I blame Martin Brest just as much for Al Pacino's terrible performance, for not dialing that guy down.
Sure. Really happy to see Woody Allen there.
Yeah, I'm happy to see Tarantino, too.
I don't know if I'd say I'm happy, but I think it's deserving.
Fair enough. That's a lot from you.
I know.
That's a big one.
I know. Neil Jordan for The Crying Game. I just feel like that movie could have been so much better. Looking at my list of nominees, the only one that didn't make it from my list was Coppola for Dracula. And I know we've had this talk, but I think there's some just visually striking stuff in that movie that still entertained me 20 years later. Right. But hugely flawed film.
I want to talk about Woody Allen, because I feel like Woody Allen, the way the camera work he did in that, the way he put that together, just changed a lot of... That changed the way a lot of stuff is now shot.
Yeah.
I think that's a very well-deserved nomination for director.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, think of like pretty much every TV show that came after that movie uses the shaky cam.
Yeah. Look, I think there's some great performances in that movie. And he, you know, he's smart. He surrounds himself with great actors.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike Coppola, who casts Keanu Reeves. And
that's why you shouldn't be nominated for Best Director.
But
you put Winona Ryder and Keanu Reeves.
I know. But... yeah, you know, so, and they're great performances, but, and I think a lot of times when you think of directors, you kind of overlook the fact that they help shape a performance, or help guide a performance, I should say. And so for that alone, I think he's definitely worth being up there amongst the nominees.
I think it's going to be Clint Eastwood.
I hope so. That's who's getting my vote.
But who do you think could beat him?
There's a lot of love for Altman. And look, Tarantino kind of changed the face.
Yeah, more with Pulp Fiction, though. I think he'll...
Yeah.
I think more Pulp Fiction was more of the genre-busting.
Yeah. It's definitely... He definitely made an impact. Who would you vote for, Danny?
It's Clint Eastwood all the way.
Yeah.
It's when you just look at this film, this list of films, just thinking of how, you know, those scripts were communicated, the most cinematically brilliant of them, and the one that I sort of think could only be realized in cinema is Unforgiven.
Yeah.
I think it's a brilliant movie. I mean, I'm using a lot of hyperbole, but it's pretty... Yeah, I don't think there's anything that stands close to it on that list.
Lee?
I wasn't a big fan of Unforgiven, but Clint Eastwood.
Yeah. That's who you would vote for?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I think he deserves it.
Yeah.
I mean, I might personal... And I'd vote for Woody Allen or Tarantino. I just like those movies better.
Right.
But Unforgiven, I recognize that it's the best of the bunch.
It's a hell of a thing, killing a man. You take away all he's got, and all he's ever gonna have.
Best Picture, we've got majority of new faces here, and the nominees are...
The Crying Game, Glengarry Glen Ross, The Player, Reservoir Dogs, Unforgiven.
And Glengarry and The Player and Reservoir Dogs are all new, taking over for... A Few Good Men, Howard's End, and Son of a Woman. Surprises?
I'm surprised that Howard's End isn't in there.
I find that so strange to see that it's even... I was not expecting Howard's End to get a single nomination.
Fair to say also, I mean, I think this list does look like... I mean, the big things here are Glengarry, Glen Ross that weren't here, you know, 20 years ago, and Reservoir Dogs. Okay, so Reservoir Dogs is a movie that sort of started out getting kind of a cult recognition, and then its reputation has only increased in time, what with, you know, Quentin Tarantino's career taking off. So I think, I mean, someone made a point at one ceremony that the cynical films tend to do better after time, and these movies that are maybe like Dances with Wolves versus Goodfellas, for instance, you know. The feel-good movies don't do so well, and I think you're seeing that reflected in this list. I think it's a good list. I'm not surprised.
Although, not to cut you off, but I'm going to. the ones that are being replaced, Few Good Men, Howard's End, and Scent of a Woman, are not exactly feel-good movies.
Well, they're more
I think Scent of a Woman
movies.
Is a feel-good movie.
Maybe.
Few Good Men's a feel-good movie in the end.
Is it?
It's a happy ending. Well,
yeah, those
know.
Are less cynical.
Those
the player ends.
Hollywood
the
film.
Player
yeah.
is a deeply
All right.
cynical movie.
All right. Okay.
So yeah, I mean, someone even said it's kind of like those are kind of more quote unquote masculine movies as opposed to feminine. I think you've got you know there's a lot of male dominated movies here.
It's a very male dominated year.
Yeah.
Oh yeah. All of them. There's none of these movies have a woman in them.
No, not even...
And we thought The Crying Game did, but it didn't.
How it turns out. We were all shocked and surprised.
Yeah, there's really no... There's none of these movies have there's no lead woman in here. It's maybe a supporting role, and that's just in two of them.
Two of them are literally all dudes.
Right.
Like, really, between Glengarry Glen Ross and Reservoir Dogs, you've got 12 guys.
Right.
Right.
Beating the piss out of each other.
The female lead in the crime game is a dude.
So. Right. So, yeah.
With the exception of Howard's End, the original list was all guy movies, too.
I guess I'm a little surprised to see Crying Game up here and not Husbands and Wives.
Oh, I would like to have seen Husbands and Wives.
Yeah.
That is surprising. How many votes did Husbands and Wives get? Was it close?
It was actually very close.
Okay.
Yeah.
Well, that makes me feel a little better.
Yeah.
Did anybody vote for Son of a Woman?
Let me see. I don't think so. Oh. Three people did.
Was one of them Al Pacino?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
The other one was Chris O'Donnell?
And Martin Brest.
Okay, that makes sense now. Yeah. I'm glad Reservoir Dogs was on there.
I went on opening night, and when it was over, I thought, God, I wish I'd made this movie. 20 years later, I feel like it's a caper movie.
Yeah, but at that time, you hadn't seen anything like that before.
Yeah.
Really, and that was...
No, it was groundbreaking, but in the end, it's not about anything. And to me, now, 20 years later, I feel like films have to have something to say. It's like, again, caper movies, heist movies, all that stuff.
But I love that genre.
Mysteries, all of that stuff pours me to tears. Procedurals, couldn't care less. It's like, great, stuff's happening. I don't care. Like, you got to give me some kind of emotional heart to, like, sink my teeth into. And so...
Do you think any of the movies from this year fit that criteria for you, or any of these nominees?
Unforgiven, I think, is probably the closest. I wish Husbands and Wives were on the list, because I think I would probably, I don't know, I think I would vote for that if it was. But from the list that's here, I'm going to go with Unforgiven.
I think I would vote for Reservoir Dogs.
I think you would, too.
I know I would.
Yeah.
I don't get a vote. Although I recognize that Unforgiven is the superior film.
Danny?
The Crying Game. That's Unforgiven.
I'm going to cut out what you say, Unforgiven.
Scent of a Woman.
I'm writing it down.
Were there any other surprises on this list?
My happy surprise
happier
was that Dyslexic Heart by Paul Westerberg got a nomination. I'm a huge Replacements fan, and I like that song.
Yeah, for best song from singles.
Yeah.
While we're on that category, I'm happy that Love Song for a Vampire from Dracula made it onto the list. Danny?
I think the big surprise for me was, and it's nice to see some stuff in the original score come in. I think Last of the Mohicans is an excellent score. I think that really tells that movie very well.
Back to your original song. I wish that people could vote for songs that maybe weren't original, that were in the movies.
You know what? They can.
But they don't. Because obviously the song of that year was from The Bodyguard, I Will Always Love You. That was the movie song of the year.
I disagree.
Really?
I would say Steeler's Wheels Stuck in the Middle.
Yes, okay, correct.
And then I would say Bohemian Rhapsody from Wayne's World.
That was another great one.
Yeah.
Maybe we should, can we just have a, write a category best use of a song in a movie?
That's what it is,
it says best original song. Well, that's why.
Yeah, that's why. But on the instructions for voting, I have told people that you can vote for anything that was in a movie. Because I actually voted for both those.
Right.
And then also...
Whitney Houston.
A Change is Gonna Come, or whatever it's called. Sam Cooke song in Malcolm X. I just think this is the silliest category. So, I'm all
best
for mixing it up.
Best original song?
Yeah. All right. Well, shall we wrap this up then?
Let's wrap it up.
I'm going to start by thanking Grand Illusion Cinema and Scarecrow Video for all of their support. They are located here in Seattle. You can find them at their websites, scarecrowvideo.com and grandillusioncinema.org. If you live in Seattle and want to come hear 15 very entertaining speakers talk about 15 of these categories that we've been talking about tonight, the 2020 Awards Ceremony is coming up on February 16th at Seattle's Fremont Abbey Arts Center. Tickets are only $10, and to get tickets or more info, you can either visit 2020awards.org or brownpapertickets.com. In addition to our presenters, we're going to have some silent auction items and our movie poster auction, which is 10 artists were commissioned to do their variations or their versions of movie posters from 1992, and those posters are pretty darn good. So you want to check them out. Go to our website, get a preview. They'll also be available for you to bid on eBay, and we'll let you know when that happens. So we hope to see you at the ceremony on the 16th, and until next time, remember, it's never too late to start thinking about the past.